Welcome, everyone.
Oh, goodness.
I'm delighted that you're all here joining us here in Rome. It's especially exciting for us to welcome you to this year's annual Medical Ethics Conference of the Center for Ethics and Culture. This is a celebration this year. This is our 30th year of the Medical Ethics Conference here at the University of Notre Dame. Originally, in 1985, this event, which predated the Center for Ethics and Culture by several years, was the brainchild of Phil Clarke, who was an alumnus of the University of Notre Dame. He became a very eminent physician and internal medicine specialist who later rose to be the dean of the University of Colorado College of Medicine, very active in the various professional societies and the medical field, but he was always a very passionate alum of the University of Notre Dame and not just an eminent physician and clinician, but also a deep humanist, and wanted to create a program in which doctors could come together once a year and discuss cases and interact with one another in a direct way, not in an abstract or theoretical way, but focusing on the clinical questions that confront physicians and that raise the deep human questions that we're going to be discussing, we have discussed for the past 30 years, that we'll continue to discuss this week. So we are very grateful to Doris and Philip Clarke for their generosity in founding this and also endowing this program, including especially this lecture this evening, which has always been delivered by a very eminent figure in the world of bioethics or medical ethics. This year is no exception. And in a moment, I'll tell you a little bit more about this evening's speaker. But this, again, welcome. This is the Center for Ethics and Culture that is, as you all know, that's sponsoring this event. We're founded in 1999 by my predecessor, Dr. David Solomon, who is a philosopher. My name is Carter Sneed. I'm a professor of law at the University of Notre Dame, where I focus on law and bioethics. And our charge at the Center for Ethics and Culture is to share and transmit the richness of the Catholic moral and intellectual tradition across a variety of disciplines, both to the students and faculty on campus, but also to project Notre Dame's voice into the public square in the name of authentic human dignity and the common good. And medical ethics is a very significant part of what we do at the Center for Ethics and Culture. So, I'd like also to mention that this year, for the first time, we are partnering with the Catholic Medical Association and a variety of their officials to bring to you a different dynamic, a new dynamic, to involve a wonderful professional society of Catholic physicians and practitioners who care very deeply about the same things that we do and are committed to the same principles and goods that we have always been committed to at the Center for Ethics and Culture. And so we're thrilled to have them involved. And you can see in the program that they've been integrated as presenters and discussants as well. So this is a celebration. You'll notice, those of you who have been coming for many years will notice that our program is a little different this year. We made a few refinements in terms of the format of the different the days that we'll be together. And that is, again, the spirit of a celebration. We're here in Rome, we're here in the Eternal City, and we want to be able to enjoy that, and so you'll notice a few refinements that hope to facilitate that as well. A lot of people have worked very hard to make this event possible, including especially Laura Nash, who is our new event planning program manager at the Center for Ethics and Culture, Pamela Canavacci, who is the conference and event director here at the Global Gateway for Notre Dame in Rome, Harriet Baldwin, who's been extraordinary for many years for us in helping facilitate our events, and her successor, Elizabeth Kuhn, academic conference specialist, Institute for Scholarship in the Liberal Arts. Lindsay Switzer, representative from Anthony Travel, is here and will answer any questions that you might have about your stay here and your trip, and she's also at the hospitality desk in the Hotel Mercure if you need any assistance. And again, we will begin the evening with the Clarke family lecture, followed by an opportunity for questions and answers. So let me introduce our speaker for this evening. We're very pleased and proud to introduce our speaker, John Keown, Professor John Keown, who is, in addition to all of his other obligations, is this year serving as our Remick Fellow at the Center for Ethics and Culture. So he's joining us as a senior research fellow with us for the entire year. His usual post is as the Rose Kennedy Chair in Christian Ethics at the Kennedy Institute of Ethics at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. He holds a law degree from Cambridge University, a doctorate from Oxford, and was later called to the bar of England and Wales, winning the prize for advocacy. He was the first holder of a lectureship in law and ethics of medicine at Cambridge, where he held fellowships at Queen's College and also at Churchill College. Professor Keown's research has been cited by the United States Supreme Court, the Law Lords, the House of Commons, the House of Lords Select Committee on Medical Ethics, and the Australian Senate, among many others. He has served as a member of the Ethics Committee of the British Medical Association and regularly consults on legal and ethical aspects of medicine. He is the author of 6 books, including his most recent with Professor Robert P. George of Princeton University, entitled Reason, Morality, and Law, The Philosophy of John Finnis, Oxford University Press. John Finnis is a name that I'm sure is familiar to all of you. He is a senior research fellow at the Center for Ethics and Culture, as well as a chair at the University of Notre Dame Law School and an emeritus professor at Oxford University. John Keown was one of his students at Oxford. So we're delighted to welcome John this evening. John Keown is a consensus, that one of the leading thinkers and speakers and writers on the question of end-of-life decision-making, euthanasia, and assisted suicide. So there's no one better to speak to us this evening than John Keown, and it's my special pleasure to introduce him to you now. So please welcome John Keown.
So let me begin by giving you an overview of my presentation this evening. I'm going to say a little about terminology, which is very important here as in elsewhere in bioethics and health law. Give a brief summary of the law internationally in relation to euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. Then summarise some of the key arguments in the contemporary ethical debate in favour and against weakening the law. And then I'll say a little about this important case in Canada. Very recently, it was on the 6th of February, so just a month ago, the Supreme Court of Canada dramatically and radically declared that there is a right to voluntary euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide in Canada. Now, that is going to prove an immensely significant precedent, not only in Canada, obviously, but in the United States and around the world. It's going to be cited by advocates of voluntary euthanasia as an important precedent that other countries should follow. So it's important to have some idea of what that case decided and why. And then I'll draw some brief conclusions. So firstly, I think it's important to be clear about how we use the word euthanasia. I use it, there's no universal meaning, to mean the intentional termination of a patient's life by a physician because it's thought to benefit the patient. So the concept of intentional or purposeful ending of life is absolutely key. We're not talking about the merely foreseen shortening of life. By a physician, the current debate really is whether physicians should be allowed to give lethal injections or at least write lethal prescriptions. And I think the notion of benefit to the patient is key because the argument for euthanasia is that death will benefit the patient, as typically by alleviating or ending the patient's suffering. Now, euthanasia can, I think, be active or passive because you can intentionally end a patient's life by an act such as a lethal injection or by deliberately switching off a ventilator. And if your intention in doing so is to end the patient's life, then I think it's proper to refer to that as euthanasia, albeit passive euthanasia. And then it can be voluntary, non-voluntary, or involuntary. And I use these to mean voluntary, where the patient has made a competent request for a lethal injection, non-voluntary, where the patient is incapable of making a request, as where the patient is a baby or someone with advanced dementia, and involuntary euthanasia, where a competent patient gets a lethal injection against his or her wishes. Now, voluntary active euthanasia, which is really what the current debate is about, should the law permit voluntary active euthanasia, lethal injections intended to end the patient's life at the request of the patient, is in most jurisdictions the crime of murder. Physician-assisted suicide, which means where a physician provides assistance to a patient to kill him or herself, is in most jurisdictions also a crime, the crime of assisting suicide. So those are that's the terminology I'll be using. In relation to the law internationally, voluntary euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide are generally illegal. There are only a few jurisdictions internationally where either is permitted. Now, in Europe, a number of countries over the last 20 or 30 years have relaxed their law to permit voluntary euthanasia. The first country to do so was the Netherlands as a result of a decision of the Dutch Supreme Court in 1984. So over 30 years ago, the Dutch legalized voluntary active euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. In 2002, the Dutch were followed by Belgium and by Luxembourg. But apart from those countries, voluntary euthanasia is illegal in the rest of Europe. In the United States, there are, of course, a handful of jurisdictions, a handful of states that allow physician-assisted suicide. Best known is, of course, Oregon, which has been followed by Washington and Vermont. And as a result of two court decisions, it seems that physician-assisted suicide is now also lawful in Montana and New Mexico, although that judicial decision is on appeal. So again, the majority of states in the US prohibit physician-assisted suicide. Thirdly, Canada, as I say, very significantly and very radically, has recently decided that there is a right to voluntary euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide under the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So the Canadian Supreme Court has given the Canadian government a year to enact legislation to comply with its decision. So it's told the government, you must draft legislation. Well, you don't have to, but if you want to, you can draft legislation to regulate the exercise of this right. But there is a right, and the law, to the extent it currently prohibits it, has been suspended. So that then is a snapshot of the law internationally. So very, very few countries indeed allow voluntary euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. Now, what's the ethical debate? Well, essentially, I'm going to focus on four major arguments. And if you want to look at 10 arguments in favor of voluntary euthanasia, you could maybe look at a recent book in which I debated an advocate of voluntary euthanasia. It's called Debating Euthanasia, surprisingly. And it's published by Hart Publishing. And the aim of the book is to give a clear, accessible summary of the arguments for and against legalization. So a medical lawyer from London wrote 30,000 words articulating her case in favor of legalization. And I wrote 30,000 words articulating a case against. We didn't actually see each other's contributions before the book was published. So what I did, my strategy, was to think of the 10 most significant arguments that she might use in favor of legalization and then answer those 10 arguments. So I think if you want to see 10 arguments rather than four that are often used to advance the cause of euthanasia, maybe have a look at that book, or at least my contribution to that book. I think the two main arguments are respect for autonomy and beneficence. So respect for autonomy would say, well, look, the decision when and how to die is very significant. And there is a principle of respect for autonomy. We should generally respect other people's choices, especially important choices such as how and when to die. We respect people's autonomy when they refuse treatment, even life-saving treatment. So why shouldn't we respect people's choices when they ask for a lethal prescription or a lethal injection? Respect for autonomy is a key principle of bioethics, and it should certainly apply to this decision, which is one of the most important decisions that people can make in relation to their medical care and how and when they die. The second major argument is that we have a duty of beneficence to alleviate other people's suffering. And if someone is suffering, if they have something like Lou Gehrig's disease, or if they have terminal cancer, and they'd rather be dead, then we owe them a duty to put them out of their misery. And of course, euthanasia has often been referred to as mercy killing. So we have a duty of mercy, a duty of compassion, to put an end to people's suffering. And so these two arguments together would warrant a law permitting voluntary euthanasia, at least to alleviate severe suffering, and at least when the patient has made a request. A third major argument in favor of changing the law is that the current law is hypocritical, that the current law says, well, no intentional killing of patients, no lethal injections, but you may administer palliative drugs which foreseeably will shorten the patient's life. So advocates of euthanasia often say, that's just hypocritical. There is no moral difference between an injection which is aimed at shortening a patient's life and an injection which foreseeably shortens a patient's life. And if there's no moral difference, then there should be no legal difference. Again, it's argued that patients have the right to refuse life-saving treatment. And if the doctor withdraws, say, a ventilator foreseeing the patient's going to die sooner, that's morally the same as giving the patient a prescription of lethal drugs, which the patient's going to take. So this is quite a significant argument as well. There is no moral difference between intentional ending of life or intentionally helping someone to kill themselves and foreseeably doing so. And a fourth argument is that concerns about sliding down slippery slopes are all misplaced, that it is possible to erect adequate safeguards against abuse. So the lawyers or the judges, the legislators, could frame adequate safeguards to ensure that there is no slippery slope to killing in a wider range of cases. You could limit the killing to really deserving cases where somebody really autonomously wants to die and they're suffering unbearably. That type of hard case, you can legislate that and prevent a slide down a slippery slope to cases where people aren't really suffering unbearably, or to cases where people don't really autonomously want to die, especially where they're incapable of asking, such as disabled babies or people with advanced dementia. Now, the response, of course, to those arguments is, I think, quite formidable. And I won't go into great detail. I'll just maybe suggest some leading responses. Again, you can look at the book Debating Euthanasia for further reflection on this. But one of the main responses to the first argument is that, yes, autonomy is important, and respect for autonomy is important, but there are limits to respect for autonomy. There are all sorts of restrictions on what we allow people to do. There are restrictions based on their own well-being. So if someone autonomously wants to sell themselves into slavery, we say no. The law won't recognize any such choice. In many countries, and I'm thinking particularly of England, the law prohibits you from requesting sadomasochism if it will, for example, result in actual bodily harm. As a leading case went to the law lords, resulting from some sadomasochistic orgy in which the perpetrators were prosecuted. And they said, well, look, the law should respect our autonomy. We're all consenting adults here. And the law lord said, well, no, there are limits on respect for autonomy. And one limit is you can't consent to the infliction of actual bodily harm on yourself. So if you can't consent to the infliction of actual bodily harm on yourself, then a fortiori, you can't consent to being killed. And the second good reason for limiting autonomy is to protect the interests of other people. So if it were the case that allowing some people to choose to be killed threatened the lives of other people, if, for example, allowing independent, autonomous people to get a lethal prescription or a lethal injection would result in less autonomous people feeling pressured or being pressured into making the request, or non-autonomous people receiving lethal injections, then that would be another very good reason for limiting or prohibiting people from accessing euthanasia or assisted suicide. In relation to the argument for beneficence, yes, of course, we have a duty to benefit others in many situations, but opponents of euthanasia would say that's where palliative care and good quality end-of-life care comes in. You can alleviate suffering without resorting to lethal injections, and in any event, killing someone is not benefiting them. On the contrary, it's ending their existence, and that can't, by definition, be a benefit. And, of course, you would not be benefiting all those other less vulnerable people who might be pressured into euthanasia or assisted suicide. There would be social consequences which would result in great harm to large groups of more vulnerable people. And the response to the third argument would be there is a significant moral and legal difference between intention and foresight, that there's a world of a difference between, for example, administering chemotherapy, foreseeing that your patient's hair will fall out and they'll suffer nausea, and administering chemotherapy intending that your patient's hair will fall out and that they'll suffer nausea. There's a world of a difference between General Eisenhower sending in the troops on D-Day to push back the Nazis, foreseeing that many of the Allied troops will be killed, as of course they sadly were, and General Eisenhower sending in the forces, intending that the Allied forces should be killed. That's an example that's been cited by the Chief Justice of the United States and by a senior law lord, just to illustrate the obvious common sense difference between intentional killing and doing things which may only foreseeably result in death. And finally, the feasibility of effective control. Opponents of euthanasia say it can't effectively be controlled. There are two main types of slippery slopes, both empirical and logical, about which we'll say a little more later. And that argument is confirmed by what we see in those few jurisdictions that have relaxed their law. So let's turn now, having summarized some of the main arguments in the ethical debate, to this very important case in Canada. The Carter case, the case of Carter against Canada. I had the privilege of being an expert witness for the Attorney General of Canada in this case, and I spent five very memorable hours being cross-examined in a Vancouver courtroom in 2011. Not an experience I would wish on anybody or I would wish to repeat, but it was a very worthwhile experience. So what did this case decide? Well, basically, the judge in the BC Supreme Court, it's actually a lower court, it's a single judge, decided that a plaintiff who had ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, had a right to voluntary euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide, whichever she wanted, and that this right was to be found in Section 7 and 15 of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Section 7 of the Canadian Charter says everyone has the right to life, liberty, and security of the person, and the right not to be deprived thereof, except in accordance with the principles of fundamental justice. Now, the paper I'm reading from is actually in the course materials, the conference materials, so I'm not going to read this at great length. You can look at the paper later, if you like, in greater detail and at greater leisure. And Section 15 of the Canadian Charter says every individual is equal before and under the law and has the right to equal protection and equal benefits of the law without discrimination, and in particular without discrimination based on race, national or ethnic origin, colour, religion, sex, age, or mental or physical disability. So the judge in Carter found that there is a right to voluntary euthanasia or assisted suicide under these provisions. The thinking here, to a large extent, was the right to life, because you may think, how can someone's right to life be infringed by a law against killing or a law against assisting suicide? Well, part of the judge's reasoning was, well, if you have a ban on voluntary euthanasia or assisting suicide, then people will be forced to kill themselves. And they'll be forced to kill themselves, particularly before they are no longer able to do it themselves. So that was the effect of the law. It was to undermine the right to life by forcing people to kill themselves. So, and in terms of Section 15, the judge found the law against assisting suicide discriminatory, because he said, well, look, there's no law against suicide, so people who are able to kill themselves can do it. But those who are too disabled to kill themselves, too physically disabled, can't. And so the prohibition on assistance unfairly discriminates against them. So for that reason as well, the law should be struck down. Now, I, as I say, wrote this article in response to the case. And it was a very surprising decision indeed. Why? Because only 20 years earlier, the Supreme Court of Canada, in the Sue Rodriguez case, had rejected the argument there is a right to euthanasia or assisted suicide. So why was this case even heard in Vancouver a few years ago? Why didn't the judge just say, well, look, the Supreme Court's already decided this. There is no right to physician-assisted suicide under the Canadian Charter. Well, she said, I think the constitutional law relating to whether the law is disproportionate, whether it disproportionately affects non-vulnerable people, has changed. So I think Canadian constitutional law has changed in relation to that. And also, we now have fresh evidence about how the law is working in countries like the Netherlands and Belgium. That evidence really wasn't before the Supreme Court. So I'm going to reopen this whole issue. which is what she did. Now, my concern with her judgment, which was, as I say, a few weeks ago, affirmed by the Canadian Supreme Court, is that it suffers from at least four serious flaws. Firstly, the judge seems seriously to have misunderstood the principle of the inviolability of life or the sanctity of life. Secondly, she misunderstood the reason why suicide was decriminalized. Thirdly, she evaded what I call the logical slippery slope argument. And finally, misinterpreted the empirical evidence from those countries which have allowed euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. So let me just say a little more about each one of those concerns. Now, this principle of the inviolability of life, it used to be called sanctity of life, but that has sort of theological connotations, so I prefer to use the word inviolability of life, is actually a foundational principle of the common law. English law, American law, Canadian law. And it's based on the notion that human beings have an intrinsic and ineliminable dignity. And it results in the exceptionless prohibition on intentionally taking innocent human life. A House of Lords Select Committee, one which Carter mentioned in his introduction, considered the arguments for legalization in 1994, and one of the main reasons they rejected those arguments was the importance of this principle of the inviolability of life. It described it in a ringing paragraph. They said that this prohibition is the cornerstone of law and of social relationships, the cornerstone of law and social relationships, which protects each one of us impartially, embodying the belief that all are equal. And I think it's a very, very nice way of encapsulating this key legal and moral principle. Now, you would have expected, if the judge in Vancouver was going to overturn this centuries-old foundational principle of law, then she would have explored it, examined it, and given really, or tried to give really good reasons for overturning it. But unfortunately, she did not do so. And it's all the more surprising, against the backdrop of what superior courts had said about this principle. In the Rodriguez case 20 years earlier, the Supreme Court, yes, by a majority 5-4, but nevertheless, the majority judgment emphasized the importance of this foundational principle. and it emphasized the key importance of the distinction between intentionally ending somebody's life and merely foreseeing ending somebody's life. So Mr. Justice Sapinka, who delivered the majority judgment, said that distinctions based on intention are important and in fact form the basis of our criminal law. And factually, it may at times be difficult to draw, but legally, the distinction is clear. And similarly, in 1997, a few years later, the US Supreme Court, in the cases of Glucksberg and Washington and Vacu and Quill, equally rejected the argument that there is a right, a constitutional right, to physician-assisted suicide. And in the course of that judgment, Chief Justice Rehnquist emphasized the importance of intention, because in the Vacu and Quill case, the plaintiffs had said, well, look, it's ridiculous. A competent person can refuse ventilation, can demand that the doctor switch off the life support machine, and the doctor does that, knowing it will shorten the patient's life, but the patient can't ask the doctor for a lethal prescription. The law is hypocritical. But the US Supreme Court rejected that argument, and Chief Justice Rehnquist said, well, there's a big difference. A doctor who writes a lethal prescription must intend to assist to make the patient dead. A doctor who switches off a life support machine need have no intention to assist the patient to end their life. The intention could just, for example, be to respect the patient's legal right to refuse treatment or to switch off a treatment which the doctor judges to be futile or too burdensome. So again, we come back to the importance of the principle and the importance of the prohibition on intentional killing. And also, the law lords in England, in a series of cases, have emphasized that the crime of murder is committed by, it requires an intention to kill, and that sometimes it's perfectly lawful and ethical for for doctors to take steps which foreseeably result in the patient's death, as by administering palliative drugs where their intention is to ease pain, even if they foresee a shortening of the patient's life. Even the Dutch, who have been performing euthanasia for 30 years, accept that euthanasia involves intentional killing, not merely foreseeing the shortening of life. Unfortunately, the judge in Vancouver blurred this important distinction. She was persuaded that there is no real distinction at all between intentionally ending life and foreseeably ending life. And if you believe that, then the law makes no sense. The prohibition on euthanasia makes no sense. And very regrettably, counsel representing the Attorney General of Canada actually conceded in the case that the criminal law made no distinction between intentionally ending life and foreseeably ending life. And that was a very regrettable and damaging concession indeed that counsel for Canada made. Because, of course, counsel for the other side can simply say, well, if Canada's accepting there's no difference between a lethal injection intended to kill and palliative care which foreseeably shortens life, and the palliative care is lawful, then the lethal injection must be lawful. So it was a disastrous concession for counsel for Canada to have made. And I think that, as I mentioned earlier, that key distinction drawn in the law reflects a key moral distinction, which is reflected in the principle of double effect, which is widely accepted in medical practice and by the professional medical associations. So you see here we have a serious mistake in the judge conflating intention and foresight, and she also seemed to misunderstand the inviolability of life because she seemed to think it meant not just no intentional killing of patients, but you must keep patients alive at all costs. And this is a very common misunderstanding of the principle of the inviolability of life. That principle does not require life to be preserved at all costs. The core prohibition is no intentional killing of patients. So those were two important confusions made by the judge, which I think helped to explain why her judgment is so open to criticism. Now let's say something about the second concern. She seemed to reason as follows. Well, suicide's been decriminalized. Therefore, suicide's ethical. Therefore, there must be a right to assisted suicide. Because if you have a right to suicide, then surely you have a right to be assisted to exercise that right. That was the testimony of the two leading expert witnesses on ethics for the plaintiffs, two leading philosophical advocates of euthanasia. They said, suicide's ethical, therefore assisting suicide is also ethical, therefore the law should permit it. But that's mistaken. Suicide was decriminalized not to condone suicide. The purpose of the decriminalization of suicide, as the Canadian Supreme Court realized in 1994, was not to condone suicide. It was out of a recognition that suicided people needed help, not punishment. So the crime of suicide was abrogated in order to encourage those who were suicidal to seek psychiatric help. It wasn't to encourage them to commit suicide at all. And that's precisely why the crime of assisting suicide was retained. And indeed, the medical profession reflected in the long-standing opposition of the World Medical Association and many national medical associations to assisting suicide, again, indicates that suicide is not regarded as ethical at all. And that's why assisting suicide itself is regarded as unethical. And the same was true in England when Parliament decriminalised suicide in 1961. Some members of Parliament said to the government minister, look, this isn't going to be seen as a condemnation, is it, of suicide, because if it is, we might not vote for it. And the government minister said, no way, it's not the government's purpose to condone what he called self-murder. That's not the purpose of decriminalization. And that's been recognized by the law lords in an important case in 2000. And they said there is no right to suicide. It remains contrary to public policy. And the purpose of decriminalization was to help people not to commit suicide. Now, the judge also ran the argument that, well, people have a right to refuse treatment, so that respects their autonomy, and therefore, assistance in suicide is a very similar thing. But of course, that's not true. The law respects your autonomous choice not to have a treatment. There is a right to refuse treatment, but that's more like a shield, if you like. It doesn't mean that because you have a right to refuse treatment, you have a right to demand treatments. You have no right to demand drugs off doctors. Equally, you have no right to demand lethal drugs off doctors. So I think that was just another flaw in the judge's reasoning. Now, there was an important argument that was put before the judge. I know, because I put it before her myself in evidence. And in fact, at the end of the 4 or 5 hour cross-examination, she posed a question to me. She'd been, I think, virtually silent the whole day while counsel for Carter was cross-examining me. And she said, well, Professor, could you just run by me again these two slippery slope arguments, the logical and the empirical? And I did. So let me run it by you. The logical slippery slope argument. Now, the judge in Vancouver said, you see, the purpose of the law, the only reason that we have a prohibition on assisting suicide is to protect vulnerable people, to help people who are more vulnerable, maybe the elderly or maybe the mentally disabled, or from being pressured into asking for suicide. So her view was, the law is overbroad because we don't need to ban assistance in suicide for everybody to protect the vulnerable. You could frame a law just to protect the vulnerable and then allow those who are not vulnerable, those who are autonomous and independent, to access assisted suicide. And that, she says, that was the purpose of the law, but it's clearly overbroad in her view. But that wasn't the purpose of the law. That's just one purpose of the law. And again, the Supreme Court in 1994 realized that the law had two purposes. Yes, obviously, it wants to protect vulnerable people from being pressured into requesting suicide. But also, the Supreme Court said in 94, a distinct purpose of the law was to underline and defend and protect the principle of the inviolability of life, to underline the wrongness of any intentional assistance in somebody else's suicide. And, as I explained to the judge, once you make any exception for certain so-called non-vulnerable people, then you embark on a logical slippery slope. And the argument, which is unanswerable, runs as follows. Even in the case of a non-vulnerable person, so let's say you have an independent, autonomous person who freely asks me for a lethal injection, because they're suffering. Doctor, I've got terminal cancer. You can't cure me. Please put me out of my misery. It's the doctor who decides whether to grant the lethal injection or not. It's not the patient. The doctor decides. And why does the doctor decide? Not just because there's an autonomous request. The doctor will often deny autonomous requests. So if the patient says, you know, the Chicago Red Sox or whatever it is have lost again, I want to be dead. I really do want to be dead. The doctor will presumably, depending which team he supports, will say, no, I'm not going to give you a lethal injection. And in the Netherlands and in Belgium, doctors do refuse a significant number of autonomous requests. They say, no, I don't think that's a good enough case for euthanasia. So it's really the doctor making the decision. And on the basis of what? On the basis of that second argument, beneficence. Do I think death would benefit you? That's really the key judgment here. If the doctor is going to give the patient a lethal injection or write a lethal prescription. And once we realize that at the end of the day, it's the doctor's judgment that death will benefit you that is thought to justify a lethal injection, then the doctor logically can make, indeed should make, precisely the same judgment in relation to his or her patients who cannot autonomously request relief from their suffering. So if you have two patients, terminal cancer, both suffering to an identical degree. One asks you for the lethal injection. You say, yes, I'll put you out of your misery. The doctor then turns to the second and obviously has to think, well, why shouldn't I put this patient out of his misery? It's the same degree of misery. Surely I owe a duty of beneficence to my non-competent patients as well. And this argument is, as I say, unanswerable. The expert witnesses for the plaintiff in Carter, I think, confirmed the validity of this argument for two reasons. One, they both ran the argument that euthanasia is justified by respect for autonomy and beneficence. And as I've just shown, the argument from beneficence will itself justify euthanasia in the case of a non-combatant person. And indeed, in both their writing, they both openly support non-voluntary euthanasia, which is a point I tried to get across to counsel for Canada. And also because, like the judge, they draw no distinction between intentional life shortening and foreseen life shortening, well then, logically, in lots of cases, you will foreseeably shorten life by, say, withdrawing a ventilator, which you think may be too burdensome to the patient. Well, if that's the same as intentionally ending the patient's life, and there's no moral difference between the two, then again, you find there is a logical connection, a logical link between euthanasia on request and euthanasia without request. So there's no escape. It's a double whammy, if you like. There are two cast iron arguments that establish the logical link between voluntary and non-voluntary euthanasia. And what did Justice Smith, having heard the argument, say in response? Well, she simply evaded it. She said, well, look, the plaintiffs in this case are just asking for voluntary euthanasia. So all that stuff about logical slippery slopes is simply irrelevant. I don't need to address it. So she just ducked, obviously, a key argument. Because, yes, the people in this case were competent and were wanting a lethal injection, but a judge has surely got to take on board the logical implications of accepting their argument, the logical implications for lots of non-competent people as well. So it was just an evasion of an unanswerable argument, which will show that once you embark on voluntary euthanasia, you are logically committed to condoning non-voluntary euthanasia. And my fourth criticism, this relates more to the other important slippery slope argument, what we call the empirical or practical slippery slope argument, which says, look, even if voluntary euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide were justified in certain hard cases, you couldn't effectively control them. First of all, you couldn't really draft sufficiently tight safeguards. What kind of words would you have to use to capture these hard cases? Unbearable suffering? Must the patient be suffering unbearably? And well, if you use that kind of terminology, what does that mean? Who's to decide whether the patient's suffering unbearably? And what kind of suffering? Physical suffering? Cancer? Or psychiatric suffering? Existential suffering? I'm very old and I'm very lonely and I want to die. Many people in the Netherlands are now saying that should be a sufficient ground. It's suffering, isn't it? And who's to decide whether it's unbearable? Well, isn't it the patient, him or herself? So just how do you, as it were, frame adequate safeguards? And then secondly, how do you police them? Once you have drafted a statute with various safeguards, who's going to enforce it? Especially in the context of the doctor-patient relationship, which is shrouded in confidentiality and privacy. Now, the evidence from abroad, which the judge, Madam Justice Smith, had before her, was, it seems to me, rather disturbing. There was disturbing evidence from the Netherlands over the last 30 years. Their own surveys, government-sponsored surveys, of doctors who have been given immunity from prosecution and a guarantee of anonymity have shown basically that thousands of patients have been given lethal injections without making an explicit request, in clear contravention of one of their key guidelines. And another key guideline, which has been breached again in thousands of cases over the last 30 years, has been the reporting requirement. Because when doctors have administered a lethal injection or issued a lethal prescription, they must report that to the authorities. And thousands of doctors just haven't bothered to do it, many because they say, we just don't want the fuss and bother of getting involved with the authorities. So they have illegally certified in those cases that death was from natural causes. Nevertheless, in spite of that concern, The frequent breach of the safeguards in the Netherlands and now more recently in Belgium. Again, the same two key failures, non-voluntary euthanasia on a wide scale and failure to report on a wide scale. And against the backdrop of a deficient system anyway, I mean, it all relies on self-reporting, whether the Netherlands, Belgium or Oregon. It's the doctor who's supposed to report him or herself to the authorities. Now, how effective can a regime based on self-reporting be? In fact, one supporter of euthanasia recognized the inadequacy of any such regime by saying it's like asking us to notify the police when we've gone over the speed limit. I mean, how many of us are going to do that? You know, it's intrinsically ineffective, is what he said. So the fact it's based on self-reporting makes it intrinsically ineffective. And in reality, there have been frequent breach of the safeguards. Indeed, the Netherlands has been now criticized twice by the UN Human Rights Committee. And in the Netherlands, illustrating that logical slippery slope argument I mentioned earlier, the courts in 1996, only 12 years after the initial judicial decision authorizing voluntary euthanasia, condoned non-voluntary euthanasia. There were a couple of cases where doctors had given lethal injections to disabled newborns, and they were prosecuted, and the court said, well, look, no, this is not a crime. Why? Because you have fundamentally the same justification as you have in the case of voluntary euthanasia. You're ending suffering. The fact that the baby can't ask for it is neither here nor there. So there is a clear illustration of the logical slippery slope. Nevertheless, in the light of all this damning evidence, Madam Justice Smith comes to the remarkable conclusion that the risks of decriminalization can be very largely avoided through carefully designed, well-monitored safeguards. Well, no country has carefully designed, well-monitored safeguards. This is a palpably wrong finding of fact on the evidence. And to confirm that, in a slightly later case in Ireland, very similar to the Carter case, a lady claiming she has a right to assisted suicide, not even physician-assisted suicide, under the Irish Constitution, a three-judge court, the Irish Divisional Court, rejected her argument. It said, no, we think that the court, the US Supreme Court in Glucksberg and Vaco got it right. We think that the Supreme Court of Canada in Rodriguez got it right. We don't buy the argument that there's no difference between intention and foresight. And we don't buy the argument that the evidence from these countries that have legalized euthanasia or assisted suicide shows that the risks can be very largely avoided. They explicitly said, having looked at exactly the same evidence that Madam Justice Smith had looked at, well, look, there's a strikingly high incidence of non-voluntary euthanasia in the Netherlands and Belgium. So, and it doesn't seem to cause any degree of concern, official concern. So the three-judge Irish court said, we just cannot agree with Madam Justice Smith on this. The evidence seems to show significant abuse of the safeguards in the Netherlands and in Belgium. Now, briefly, the Supreme Court of Canada last month essentially affirmed Madam Justice Smith's judgment, basically agreed with it. And I'll briefly suggest at least four, criticisms of the Supreme Court's judgment here. First of all, their adoption of euphemism and vagueness. When you read you have to read the judgment several times. It's much shorter, mercifully, than Madam Justice Smith's, which went on for page after page after page. I think over 1,000 paragraphs. The Supreme Court of Canada, its judgment is so vague. It's not exactly clear what it's deciding, what it's permitting. Why? Because it talks throughout about physician-assisted dying. Now, I always avoid that phrase. You'll notice it's going right back to terminology. I have a clear definition of euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. Lots of advocates of reform like the phrase physician-assisted dying. Well, first of all, it's a euphemism. It sounds very cozy and comfortable. There's nothing wrong with dying, and there's nothing wrong with being assisted by a physician in dying, but it blurs what's at stake. It blurs the difference between, say, good palliative care, good end-of-life care, and intentional ending of life. And it also blurs the distinction between euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. So some people use physician-assisted dying to mean physician-assisted suicide, and some use it to include euthanasia. And you read the judgment of the Supreme Court, and it's not entirely clear how they're using it. So that's why the case was widely reported in the media as Canadian Supreme Court says there's a right to physician-assisted suicide. But actually, I think they're affirming the first instance judgment in Vancouver, which permits both. So I think the Supreme Court decision is upholding a right not just to physician-assisted suicide, but to voluntary euthanasia as well. But it's a damning criticism that it's not entirely clear just precisely what the court is deciding. So euphemism and vagueness, shoddy legal and ethical reasoning. It endorses the trial court's view that the law breaches people's right to life because it forces them to kill themselves before they are no longer able to do it, that it infringes their autonomy and their security of the person. It forces them to suffer. It gives them this stark choice: kill yourself or suffer an agonizing death. I mean, that's just a false dichotomy, isn't it, between the choices available. It again, just like the trial court, evades the important logical slippery slope argument. And when it comes to the judge's factual finding that the risks of decriminalization can be avoided, they say, well, we can really overturn that factual finding if we think it's palpably wrong. And we don't think it's palpably wrong, and so we're going to uphold her judgment. But clearly it was palpably wrong. The court was aware that the Irish Divisional Court had looked at the same evidence and rejected it, and nevertheless doesn't even engage with that. It doesn't even say, well, actually, yeah, we must take on board what this three-judge court in Ireland has said. But the case of Fleming is just mentioned briefly and not really on this point at all. So it really is an appallingly reasoned decision. And again, as with the trial court, no real examination of the key principle of the sanctity of life, and no real key explanation of why it's being overturned, what the sanctity of life means, and the just insufficient judicial reasoning even to attempt to justify overturning this fundamental and historic legal principle. So in conclusion, we see the international position is still that only a handful of countries allow euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. What we're witnessing is what I call creeping legalization. And I think this is what we're likely to see over the next 5 or 10 years. One country after another is likely to relax its law to permit either voluntary euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. And what's happening is that the courts seem to be the increasing resort of advocates for reform, because advocates of voluntary euthanasia have tried repeatedly to persuade legislatures to change the law and have failed repeatedly, because legislators and their expert committees can study the evidence calmly and coolly, can listen to all sides of the debate, and they can see the real dangers that are involved in relaxing the law. And so advocates of change are now trying their luck before the courts, and in courts, in jurisdictions like Canada, where the courts have the power, effectively, to overturn democratically enacted legislation, then there is very little that Parliament can do in response. What we're witnessing, in effect, is judicial activism in the form of Roe and Wade and Morgenthaler in Canada now being applied at the end of life. It'll be interesting to see how many other courts in how many other jurisdictions follow the Canadian Supreme Court. But the important point I'd like to conclude on is that it's really vital for those of us who are opposed to relaxation of the law to promote greater understanding of the case against, because, as I've suggested, these judges clearly demonstrate a very poor grasp of even key foundational principles instantiated in the law and of the key difference between intending and foreseeing death. And the continued opposition of the healthcare professions, who are well aware of the importance of those distinctions, is absolutely vital. And also vital is the importance of improving end-of-life care, which is still of insufficient quality and insufficiently available to so many people. And when people see their loved ones dying in pain or distress, they become supporters of voluntary euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. So it seems to me all is not lost. The countries that are legalizing either are still a trickle rather than a flood, and it's all to play for. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John, for that wonderful talk. I'll take the moderator's privilege and ask you the first question, then we can open up to the broader audience. One thing that's interesting about the debate over assisted suicide and euthanasia in the United States, and I think more broadly around the world, is that it's still a bioethical or medical ethical question that doesn't always divide neatly along partisan or political ideologies. Whereas in the life issues and others, you see there's a fairly good proxy for right and left ideology that you can map that onto those. Whereas in assisted suicide, especially in the United States, you have physicians who largely oppose assisted suicide. You have people like Art Kaplan who associate themselves with the political left who are opposed to assisted suicide. People like Ezekiel Emanuel. In 2012, we saw an interesting development. There was a referendum proposed in Massachusetts in 2012 to legalize assisted suicide, which failed because, in part, because of the work of some members of the community there who got the people, the voters' attention about concerns that perhaps they hadn't thought of before. But the real argument was from people like Ezekiel Emanuel from the Obama administration, Vicky Kennedy, Ted Kennedy's widow, and even the Boston Globe editorial page came out and said, while in principle we favor assisted suicide for reasons of autonomy, as you sketched out, in practice and in the real world, the concerns about fraud, abuse, mistake, and duress are so worrisome, and the reality is that autonomy is in many instances not possible here, that there may be a small sliver of people for whom the right to assisted suicide would be beneficial, but that's at the cost of endangering a wide variety of the most vulnerable among us who would be euthanized or assisted in suicide or coerced into that against their wishes, and it's just not worth it. I mean, how many instances of non-voluntary or even involuntary euthanasia are worth legalizing assisted suicide for the very wealthy and able-minded? So with respect to these empirical questions, in the U.S. Supreme Court, the court took the view in 1997 that the burden is with those who want to legalize assisted suicide to show that these concerns are not overwhelmingly, you know, decisive in whether we should legalize assisted suicide. Now it seems to be the case that the proponents of assisted suicide are saying, no, the burden is on us. The people who don't want to legalize assisted suicide have to show empirically that this cause of duress and worry is the real thing. And they say, well, it hasn't happened in Oregon, it hasn't happened in Washington, it hasn't happened in the Netherlands or Belgium. And the answer is, well, we actually don't know what's going on in those places because the record-keeping system is not sound enough. So my question to you is, how do you make the case to someone who is in principle in favor of these practices because of their commitment to autonomy, but who is still movable, as are the folks that I mentioned before, and the New York Task Force on Life and the Law from 1994, who came out against assisted suicide in the state of New York because of these worries about these sort of side effects not in principle. How do we make that case to people like the Canadian Supreme Court so that they take seriously our arguments and don't simply go with the most theoretical justification and allow this to go forward?
Well, I think one thing to do is just to educate people about how many secular expert bodies have come out against reform. So you can say, well, it's not just my say-so. Look at the New York State Task Force
report. The AMA, the WHO.
Exactly. And then people begin to think, well, it's not the usual suspects. It's not the Catholic bishops who are pushing this. It's the World Health Association, you know, World Medical Association. And expert committees that have looked at Parliament. So the Canadian Parliament had considered six bills and had rejected them all. So I think that's what I point to, that although superficially there is a case for voluntary euthanasia, there is a superficially attractive case for it.
Sure.
And we see it being made by the media on a regular basis. I see Diane Rehm is now becoming a leading figure in the debate after her husband starved himself to death. So she says she's now going to use her program to promote discussion. So I wrote a little piece in the journal edited by Mike Bradley at Notre Dame, saying, well, bring it on, because, yeah, let's have more discussion, because when there's more discussion, we're able to refute some of those superficially attractive arguments that are paraded before us by the mass media. So fine, if the discussion is going to be balanced, I think we win. We have the best arguments. As these secular committees, like the New York State Task Force, several of the members, as you know, were in favor in principle of voluntary euthanasia.
I think they were all in favor of it.
And they said, well, nevertheless, we are, having looked at the arguments, having looked at what happens in places like the Netherlands, having looked also at how there are lots of vulnerable people in the States who haven't got health insurance, then we're unanimously opposed to it. And it was similar with the House of Lords Committee in the same year, very secular, liberal committee. One cleric, the Archbishop of York, the Anglican Archbishop of York, who was very pro-embryonic stem cell research, unanimously came out against it for the same reasons. And they went to the Netherlands, and the chair, Lord Walton, eminent doctor, came back and said, we were, you know, just very disturbed by what we saw, particularly the incidence of non-voluntary euthanasia. You know, the number of people getting lethal injections who had not made a free and voluntary request, as the Dutch guidelines require. So I think we do actually know quite a lot of what's happening, especially in the Netherlands, because of their surveys over the years, and increasingly about Belgium. Now, Oregon, of course, people make great claims that, well, there's not been any abuse in Oregon. But as even some of the supporters of physician-assisted suicide say in relation to Oregon, we really don't have any comprehensive data comparable to the Dutch. There have been no surveys comparable to the Dutch government surveys to tell us precisely what's happening. And in fact, before the Dutch surveys were published, the Dutch were saying, everything's fine, there's no slippery slope, there's no abuse. And then it turned out that thousands of people were getting lethal injections without asking for them. So I think that's the situation, that we can actually point to very disturbing evidence of what happens. Now, of course, opponents might say, yeah, but those are countries where they've got lethal injections. Right. Here in the States, we just want lethal prescription. But of course, that's just a first step, because precisely the arguments, the moral arguments for lethal prescriptions, autonomy and beneficence, are the arguments for lethal injections, especially for those who can't physically kill themselves. Right. So once you make any kind of exception, once you have physician-assisted suicide, you're inevitably going to end up with lethal injections. I mean, the Dutch themselves say you can't just have physician-assisted suicide. They say it's a fantasy. It won't work for all sorts of reasons. One reason is people often don't kill themselves properly. So in the Netherlands, in one study, about 20% of cases where the doctor was present failed because the patient vomited up the drugs or something, and the doctor stepped in with a lethal injection. So the Dutch tell us you can't just, the physician-assisted suicide is only kind of a halfway house. You've got to go the whole hog. And I think morally that's right. And any consistent advocate for physician-assisted suicide has got, I think, consistently, ethically, to advocate for voluntary euthanasia as well. And then, as I argued, for non-voluntary euthanasia, because if death's a benefit for these poor suffering people, it's a benefit for those poor suffering people who can't ask for it. And if we don't give it, then we're discriminating against them on the basis of their intellectual disability.
So let's open the floor. Yes.
Jeff, Rivers. I'd like to shift the discussion to the global south. In your international context, it was Canada, Europe, and the United States. What is the state of the debate, let's say, in the developing world? Africa, South Central America, the Caribbean. And I raised the question to get ahead of the game. Right now, to a large extent, in Canada, the US, Europe, we're playing catch up, right? So we're playing sort of a rear guard action philosophically now. In anticipation of the fact that this movement's going to spread, what is your sense of what the state of the discussion is, A? B, for those who have footprints in parts of the world where this discussion has not surfaced, what would be your preemptive strategy so that we don't have to, in the global south, be playing the catch-up game that we're now playing here in the north?
Right. Well, I think it's fair to say that the real push for legalization is in North America, Canada, and Europe. So a German colleague told me that the debate is about to take off in Germany, and if Germany changes its law, that will be a dreadful precedent. So Europe, North America is where the debate really is heating up, and Australia. There are constant attempts in Australia to reform their law as well. I don't sense that, and South America is still, I think, at the stage of more of debating their law on abortion more than their law on euthanasia. But there are some moves there. So the Supreme Court of Colombia has changed the law in Colombia in relation to euthanasia. So I'm having to dust up my Spanish now in preparation for reading the judgment. But I think the next stage will be probably, after North America and Europe, it will be Latin America, I think. I don't sense anything bubbling under in Africa. I've spoken to one or two African colleagues who say, actually, Africans are desperate to get life-saving drugs. You know, euthanasia is the last thing on their mind, you know. So, yeah, I just, that's right.
Let's start living first, yeah, and then exactly. We can worry about dying.
Yeah. And just on a related point, which touches on my final point about improving end-of-life care, it really is, it's scandalous the way in which there is virtually no palliative care in sub-Saharan Africa. And culturally, I was reading, there's an annual biannual report on the global state of palliative care, and it said in some African countries, that's how you're expected to die, in agony. And the doctor will say to you, don't complain, this is what death is. And if you want to die properly, then you suffer. You know, there's just no sympathy or attempt, or they don't really think in terms of palliative care. So we have a lot of work to do to evangelize other countries on the importance of good quality end-of-life care. And even in our own countries, because there are terrible shortfalls in Canada, in parts of America, in Europe, even in the UK, we're one of the world leaders for end-of-life care, the home of the hospice movement founded by Dame Cicely Saunders. There are still 100,000, at least 100,000 people a year with unmet palliative care needs. So we have no room for complacency whatsoever. And as I say, everyone who sees a relative die is a potential, in pain, is a potential recruit to the euthanasia cause. And many of the leading people advocating for euthanasia, when you ask them why, are you such a keen? I saw my mother die like a dog. And I have to sympathize with that. It's a totally understandable reaction that many people have.
Okay, Dr. Ryan Nash from Ohio State University.
Hi, sorry. Thank you for a really comprehensive and excellent talk and paper. I'm a palliative care doc also. I'm the head of bioethics at OSU as well. I agree with your presuppositions and much of your conclusion. I have some questions about your argument, though. And I want you to correct me. In your first line of argument about the principle based on common law on the inviolability of human life, you suggest in the paper that most, if not all, civilized cultures, societies hold this. And that seems to be a very recent narrative, though, at least in U.S. history, from my reading. Seems to come up in the 1960s and 70s. It's codified in the 1970s. I know in Texas, where I'm from, and this is also, I mean, a culture that, voluntarily giving oneself into bodily harm, getting on the back of a bull or a bucking bronco or something like that is common in the cultural ethos. There was in the colonies, in early American history and in early Texas history, this libertarian, there's no state interest in even the things of death. So in Texas in 1902 and in the 20s and in the 30s, there's case law to defend mercy killing, where the courts decided and exonerated mercy killing. And Texas doesn't pass a law against assisted suicide until the 70s. So I wonder, could there be, I know what common law is, I don't know what a principle of common law is, but couldn't one argue that there's a principle of common law that would be non-interference? I share your presupposition. Both of these things are evil, an abomination to God, and they should not be legal or they shouldn't be done.
Thank you for that. I'm tempted to make a quip about why we're including Texas in civilized societies, but I
go ahead.
But let's grant that supposition, you know. The principle of the common law is reflected in the judge-made law, basically, and that was the law taken to the colonies. So Blackstone's commentaries, which people like Abraham Lincoln would carry around with him, does reflect the principle of the inviolability of life. So when one looks at the law of homicide, it's clear that there is a constant historic prohibition on intentionally killing innocent people. And it's absolute. So that is one of the few really foundational key historic principles of English common law. When you deal with questions of, what risks does the law allow people to take with their life, you know, can you go hang gliding, parachuting? In a sense, there are limits, of course, on the risks that you can take. I think there are things that the law would not allow you to consent to. But in terms of the sanctity of life, the inviolability of life, it's pretty clear that the prohibition on intentional killing is one of probably the most foundational principle of Anglo-American law, I would say. So to the extent if courts in the 30s went the other way, then they're the exception who proved the rule. Yeah. Really. But thank you for that.
Dr. Redinger, we have you next on in the queue.
Hi. So I'm a psychiatrist, and I do inpatient work primarily. And so I'm routinely involved in involuntarily hospitalizing patients because in Michigan law, the standard is they appear to be in imminent danger to themselves or others, which at least in Michigan, imminent is considered to be 72 hours. And so I complete a legal document that attests that, and that initiates a civil proceeding where a judge comes into our inpatient psychiatric unit and we have a assistant prosecutor and I testify and there's a public defender with the patient to argue against. And then the judge decides yes or no, the patient needs to be involuntarily hospitalized or treated with medications against their will. But it seems to me that this opens up, at least in all of my experience, my cases, they're all suffering. We never get to the point of, well, why do you want to kill yourself? Because they all have justified reasons for wanting to end some suffering in some way. And so it's just presumed that being suicidal is a de facto indication that they're not acting autonomously and that they need to be hospitalized and treated. So how does the law now, how do places that have legalized this, how do they deal with this incongruity in civil law where you have some suicidal patients that are viewed as justifying their actions, but the vast majority of which I assume in Canada also are still involuntarily hospitalized for voicing this opinion or for voicing the desire to want to die?
So they're involuntarily hospitalized because they're ruled to be incompetent and in need of mental psychiatric care. That's the, yeah. And the question is, so why don't laws permitting assisted suicide equally require psychiatric evaluation?
You get a group of patients, or a group of individuals who are suicidal.
Yeah.
But the law in some cases seems to spew this is justified, and the vast majority of other cases this isn't justified.
And yeah, that's a...
How does it rectify that?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, because the starting point should surely be that a suicidal wish raises questions about one's competence and mental state, which is reflected in the laws relating to admission, compulsory admission to mental institutions. But it doesn't in relation to assisted suicide, and certainly not to the same degree that it should. So the Royal College of Psychiatrists in 2006, when a bill was being proposed to, you know, an Oregon kind of bill was introduced in the House of Lords, issued a statement flagging all these concerns that, well, people who are suicidal, whether they're terminally ill or not, you know, are often clinically depressed. And we're very concerned that family doctors aren't trained to diagnose clinical depression, or even if they do recognize it, think it's normal and doesn't need any attention, when the reality is it takes an expert to assess it and to treat it. And once it's treated, 98 to 99% of people who say they want to kill themselves change their mind. So you would expect that proposals to change the law would have built into them a psychiatric filter to ensure that this person is entirely competent, and if they're depressed, they get treatment for their depression. But what's interesting is that none of the laws really do that. So there's no requirement in the Netherlands or Belgium or Oregon for patients to see a psychiatrist. It's quite remarkable. It's one of the great weaknesses in those laws. Now, the Oregon law says if the one of the two doctors thinks there may be some reason to question the competency of the patient, then they should refer. But they rarely do, and perhaps not surprising, because if the Royal College of Psychiatry is right, ordinary doctors aren't very good at spotting depression. So it's interesting that the same red flags aren't raised in relation to assisted suicide legislation. You'd expect them to be hedged around with all sorts of requirements to ensure that the patient was competent and was not requesting a lethal prescription out of depression. But they don't. I think it's a great weakness in those laws.
And I would add that the doctors in Oregon have made the point that most of the doctors that write these prescriptions in Oregon are associated with Compassion and Choices, formerly known as the Hemlock Society. I'm not sure why they changed their name. They've gone on the record, and their medical director has gone on the record saying that the desire for suicide is a fitting response in many instances to these instances of terminal illness and putting aside the question of clinical depression. Okay, we have four more questions in the queue. Oh, there's another there. And multiple. Okay, we'll just keep going for a little while if you guys want to keep going. But let's do this. Let's have the next four questions in succession, and then you can respond to sort of as.
Please do. I'm being paid per question, so keep it coming.
So let's start with Donna Harrison. We have Dr. Harrison is next in the queue, and then we'll get that fill in.
I read your handout on the way in, and something struck me that the proponents of euthanasia or assisted suicide are depending on this doctor-patient relationship. And it seems to me that the unique part of the doctor-patient relationship that made it different than every other contract was the Hippocratic Oath. And so here you have the reliance on this unique relationship, which is in turn dependent on the Hippocratic Oath, but which assisted suicide is in and of itself a violation of that thing which forms the doctor-patient relationship. So I would like you to comment on whether or not that is something that could be brought into the argument. And the second thing is to comment also on the current war on conscience for physicians right now. So maybe the response in the Global South would be to ensure that there are conscience clauses that physicians can actually get training, because as you know in the UK right now, if you have a conscientious objection, you cannot train in reproductive health. So if you'd comment on that.
Okay, so we're going to go through the questions, and you can keep track of the questions and answer them all in one. Okay. This gentleman here had a question next. He's in the queue.
Yeah, I am a medical oncologist, and over the last few years, with the insurance changes, we noticed more of our patients refusing potentially life-saving medications and treatments. And so there is this, as I'm listening to your lecture, there is this question of economy popping up in my head. Was it studied? Is there any data from Netherlands, for example, whether economic status has any impact on the decision making, or are we going to see maybe initially it may not, but later on when more people have access because of legal situation changed, that will have an impact. And another issue, I guess, question would be in populations where are moving to the older populations and we're younger, like China, for example, will we see a societal pressure on this issue?
Dr. Bill Kishore is next in the queue.
Yeah, I'd like to ask if the Dutch position on pediatric euthanasia incorporates a notion of unbearable suffering, which simply cannot be documented. Because in many cases, the euthanasia is practiced on the basis only of a genetic diagnosis, with really no feedback from the patient as to whether the patient is suffering at all. Do I understand this correctly? And if so, it seems like a very serious misinterpretation of beneficence.
Dr. Franzak over here is next in the queue.
I would like to say that in my possible opinion of this is that physicians have dropped the ball, and they don't like to deal with these issues. And as a result of ignoring these issues, we end up having to take these things into court. I mean, if you look at this purely medically, euthanasia is not a good therapy, for example, like treating appendicitis or ectopic pregnancy. But yet, the easy way out to treating someone who's in severe distress and suffering is to simply put them to sleep forever. There's some exciting new work being done now. I don't know if anybody's read the New Yorker magazine about the docs there using psychedelic drugs to treat cancer patients. And they're having long-lasting effects far beyond the metabolic life of the drug, and it's beginning to help people. My point is, we're not investigating these end-of-life issues like physicians. And if we did, we might end up coming up with some better answers.
This gentleman in the over here is the next in the queue.
Dan Byros here. I'm a veterinarian at the MSPCA in Boston. And health. Yeah. So, and now for something completely different, right? Do you think, this is a short question, maybe it's a short answer, but do you think the moral bearings of veterinary euthanasia and its acceptance have spilled over into the human discussion on euthanasia? And indirectly, I'd love to hear your perspective on that.
This gentleman in the back here is next in the queue with his hand up.
The cases of non-voluntary euthanasia you spoke of in children, I assume, or am I right in assuming, not that it would justify it, but those were performed with the consent of the parents? And also, is there any evidence of non-voluntary euthanasia with adults?
John, did you have your question? The last question will be John Sugar from the Mayo Clinic.
Thanks, and I just reiterate everybody else's comments. Thanks very much for a great presentation. Very clear. I'm going to ask a simple but I don't think naive question, and I just like to follow up Dr. Bishop's comment and broaden this a little bit. In regard to your comments on palliative medicine, I see a lot of people at the end of life. I'm not a palliative care specialist, and I defer to my colleagues here on that, but it seems to me that there still are many cases where we would be left with difficult suffering at the end of life. It can be palliated, but you can't do away with suffering. And you know, my question is, John Paul II in his one of his documents on suffering talks about the intimidation factor of suffering, not particularly to the patient themselves, but to those around them. The intimidation to those around them. And while I'm very sympathetic with any sort of natural reason arguments, whether they be logical or legal or natural law arguments, I'm sympathetic to those arguments, certainly. But my question is, independent of a broader metaphysics, and let's be specific, a metaphysics that's open to transcendence, sort of a religious perspective broadly defined, is the gravity in our society such that in the end, whatever legal, natural law, natural reason arguments are put out, that we're going to ultimately move towards euthanasia just because, absent a transcendent outlook, there's no way of facing suffering? Thanks.
Yeah. And in the time, so respond okay to all those questions.
Right. So question one, yes. Question two, no. Question no. So the Hippocratic Oath, yes, one of the main objections to euthanasia raised by the medical profession is precisely this, that the oath has written in it in terms, you know, I will not assist the patient to commit suicide or give no assistance at all. So it is a long and established part of the notion of medicine as a profession, which is there to serve the patient, and also a recognition of the immense power that doctors have over patients. It's a self-limiting ordinance, if you like, that's crucial to the bond of trust between doctor and patient. So, of course, Leon Cass and Ed Pellegrino explored this notion at some depth. And a legal colleague of mine, Alex Capron, put it rather nicely when he once said that, he said, I don't want to worry when the doctor comes into my room, my hospital room, whether he's wearing the white coat of the healer, the white coat of the healer, or the black hood of the executioner. You know, you just don't want to be having to guess now what's in the syringe today. You know, so, and I think the Hippocratic injunction is key to the maintenance of that trust that you will not be ever written off by your carer, by your healer. He will make whole, not try and destroy. In terms of conscientious objection, if laws are going to be enacted, if judges are going to require laws to be enacted, then this should be part of any law that is drafted. The Canadian Supreme Court said, well, we're not really commenting on conscientious objection. That's a matter for Parliament when it drafts its laws. But, of course, even if you were to say no one needs to perform euthanasia, would the law say, well, at least you have to refer to someone who is willing to perform euthanasia, and what price your conscientious objection then? So even if some provision is made, it may be quite inadequate to protect someone's wish not to have any involvement at all with the procedure. Second question, economic aspects. I think it's fair to say at the moment there, I'm not aware of any real evidence that that financial pressures are behind requests for euthanasia in the Netherlands or Belgium or Oregon. For example, in places like the Netherlands, people are covered by health insurance, so usually there's no cost if they want to carry on being treated. And in Oregon, from the information we have, although of course that is, I think, incomplete, the question is how incomplete, people opting for physician-assisted suicide seem to be very highly educated and affluent. So that's the position now. In time, I think it very likely the situation may change as healthcare resources get scarcer, as the economic situation perhaps worsens. And I think we need to bear in mind that there are crucial cultural components to this whole debate. It's not just an individual question concerning the doctor and patient. This is a cultural shift of immense proportions. Because if we change the law, then we as a society are saying that we think life in certain conditions is no longer worth living. These people would actually be better off dead. Those wouldn't, but these would. And then we have to explore the question, well, who do we think would be better off dead? And this is where the important voice of the disability movement has been raised, because they say, it's us, we're the ones who are going to be judged to have lives not worth living. And they've played a really significant role in retarding the push to relaxation of the law. And inevitably, I think, people will ask themselves, even if they're not suffering a disability, well, really, I know now that this option is available. Isn't it rather selfish of me not to choose it? There was one cultural commentary which I thought was very good. It didn't really take a moral position, but she said there will be profound cultural shifts. The medical profession will change in its thinking. It won't just the law that will change, the culture will change, the medical profession. And people will begin to ask themselves, look, what's the point of me lingering for another 6 months or a year? I know I'm causing inconvenience. Why don't I end it now? And of course, the relatives might themselves prompt that question in the elderly person. And it's significant that a significant proportion of people in Oregon say that the sense of feeling a burden is one of the reasons that they want a lethal prescription. So I think in the long term, that would actually become a significant dimension in the cultural shift. Thirdly, the Dutch, yes, the Dutch do require the child to be suffering unbearably, but again, that's a rather vague concept. It's not self-evident what unbearable suffering is, especially when you're having to make that judgment on behalf of somebody else. So there are all sorts of questions. It's not just terminally ill children. Those guidelines now apply to children who could live quite some time, and there are judgments being made about low quality of life. So it's not clear cut. And I agree entirely that when you're making that decision for somebody else, it's even more problematic than when the individuals make it for himself. The point about the medical profession, yeah, I agree. The medical profession, I think, has to a significant extent failed in relation to end-of-life care. One of the points Ezekiel made is that the reason he doesn't like this debate is that it's a distraction from what the vast majority of people want, which is just good end-of-life care. Not many people are going to want physician-assisted suicide. They just want good, decent end-of-life care, and many of them don't get it. And I don't think it's been a high priority for the medical and nursing professions, and it should be. So I take your point entirely. Leakage from veterinary medicine to euthanasia. Well, certainly to the extent that a common argument used is you wouldn't let an animal die like this, so why shouldn't we be able to give lethal injections to humans? To which the answer is, of course, that's fine if you want to treat people like dogs. I think maybe there's an overlap. Maybe coming on to the next point about a cultural shift, the lack of a metaphysical or theological explanation for the wrongness of killing. I think the breakdown in religious belief and religious affiliation is an important cultural backdrop to this whole debate. People are simply asking, well, I don't think there's anything coming after, I don't think there's a God, and who are you to tell me I have to suffer? You know, so I think that is part of the cultural framework, the cultural backdrop, to which the answer is, I think, the secular philosophical answer that the House of Lords Committee adopted, that really the prohibition on intentional killing is based on a respect for the fundamental human right, that is based on our intrinsic dignity as human beings, and that we don't want to make the judgment that some human beings have lives worth living and others don't, because it's fundamentally discriminatory. So I don't think one needs to invoke theological explanations or metaphysical explanations to convey that basic truth about fundamental human equality. And another question, is there adult non-voluntary euthanasia in the Netherlands and Belgium? Yes, and a significant amount of it. In 1990, the report disclosed there were 1,000 patients who were given a lethal injection without request, and about 2.5 who had made a request. So a really significant proportion were killed without a request. That number has now gone down to about 500 in the last report I saw. But still 500, these are all cases of murder in Dutch law, all in flagrant violation of their guidelines. So the Dutch are trying to put a good spin on it by saying, well, we're now getting this under control. But when you look at what's happened over the last 30 years, it is just a fact that thousands of Dutch people have been given a lethal injection without request. So the Dutch controls, I think, have proved, you know, signally ineffective. And I think that was about it, isn't it?
Fantastic.
Good, okay. So.
Thank you very much, John. We appreciate it. Thank you all for coming. The opening night of our conference, we're well underway. And I think you all have information from Anthony Travel about tomorrow morning's tours, if you're interested. Laura Nash will be happy to help you with that. Anthony Travel representative is at the Mercure Hotel. We will begin our first session tomorrow at 2 p.m. With a comparative discussion of public access to experimental treatments and its legal limits in the case of Italy by our friend and colleague, Dr. Andrea Rovignati. So thank you all very much. Have a lovely evening. We'll see you tomorrow.